I'm Father Anthony Cicada. Welcome to broadcast number 13 for the Philothea Press bestseller, Work of Human Hands, a theological critique of the Mass of Paul VI, by the Reverend Anthony Cicada. To order Work of Human Hands, visit www.sggresources.org. Chapter 12, Part 2, The New Eucharistic Prayers, Fraudulent History, Hippie Theology. In our last broadcast, we heard the experts who directed the liturgical reform after Vatican II dismiss the venerable Roman Canon as liturgical decadence and plot its demise. This broadcast will examine what they created to replace it. The Eucharistic prayer. In place of the one invariable prayer, there are now at least 13 different texts approved for general use. We will also examine the changes introduced in the most important part of the Mass, the consecration. The promulgation of the new Eucharistic prayers. In 1968, a year before the new order of Mass appeared, Paul VI promulgated 4 Eucharistic prayers, or EPs. The first EP was a revised version of the old Roman Canon. EPs 2, 3, and 4 were new texts. But 1974 turned out to be the real boom year in the Eucharistic prayer market. As a wind-up to the 1975 Holy Year, Paul VI approved 2 new EPs for reconciliation, 3 for children, and another for the Swiss Synod that contained 4 variants. Thus, the current edition of the Missal of Paul VI contains 13 Eucharistic prayers. But that may change. Francis, unlike Benedict XVI, has a more freed-up outlook on stuffy liturgical traditions. So some liturgists believe he will be open to approving still more Eucharistic prayers. The structure of the new EPs. The new Eucharistic prayers have a similar structure and form, like the product of some liturgical cookie cutter. This is because their authors adhered to the criteria laid down by modernist textual critics. These 20th century academics figured out what elements a real Eucharistic prayer should contain, unlike, say, that dodgy old Roman canon. There are 9 elements in each prayer, but we will mention only one of them here, the epiclesis. This is a technical term for a prayer that calls upon the Holy Ghost to descend upon the offerings and to sanctify them. The epiclesis was another hobby horse from the pre-Vatican II liturgical movement chorale. Why? Ecumenism, of course. In the woolly sacramental theology of the Eastern schismatics, the words of consecration recited over the bread and wine do not suffice in themselves to transform the elements into the body and blood of Christ. One must call down the Holy Ghost with an epiclesis. Only then does the transformation occur. So, just as the revisers removed the offertory to accommodate heretics in the West, they inserted an epiclesis to accommodate the schismatics in the East. Nothing woolly there, about the reason, that is. The reduction of priestly gestures. The rubrics for the canon of the traditional Mass prescribe that the priest make a great number of ritual gestures during the prayer. These include profound bows, signs of the cross, raising and joining his hands, raising his eyes, extending his hands over the gifts, elevations of the sacred species, genuflections, striking his breast, and kissing the altar. In the new EPs, the gestures were reduced to a functional minimum. Why? Taken together, the multiple ritual actions in the traditional rite conveyed ideas that the new rite was designed to diminish or suppress entirely. The unique role of the priest in offering the sacrifice, the mystical otherworldliness of the sacred action taking place, man's lowliness before God's holiness, and the miracle of the real presence. The gestures, because they were directed to God, diminished the attention the presider was supposed to lavish on the celebrating assembly. They also immersed the priest's personality as an individual into the person of Christ, the very opposite of the new notion of priest as enthusiastic animator presider. Finally, the old rite required that the priest keep his thumbs and forefingers joined after the consecration, out of profound reverence for the Blessed Sacrament, for each particle was precious. Paul VI abolished this powerful symbolic gesture during the very years in which modernist heretics were most openly attacking the dogma of transubstantiation. The New Eucharistic Prayers. We can't analyze all 13 Eucharistic prayers in detail here. A few comments on each will have to suffice. For more information, we refer you to Chapter 12 of Work of Human Hands. EP 1, The Roman Canon. Although EP 1 is subtitled Roman Canon, and that is how a priest like Father Retro invariably refers to it, that label is incorrect. Other texts may be substituted for it. So by definition, it is no longer a canon, no longer a fixed rule. Apart from this, there are other changes. One affected the lengthy lists of saints in the prayers Communicantes and Novus Quoque Peccatoribus. The revisers regarded the recitation of these names as objectionable on grounds of, quote, historical criticism, unquote, and moreover because they were, quote, burdensome. So, 21 names in the first prayer and 11 in the second prayer are bracketed as optional. Since these saints appeared in the canon precisely because they enjoyed great popularity in Rome, it makes no sense to continue to call EP1 the Roman canon if it can now be recited without them. Most importantly, the consecration was completely reworked, but more on that later. EP2, Hippolytus. This EP is the shortest, so if we're talking canons, it's surely the fastest gun in the West. Because of its alleged antiquity, moreover, it was supposed to have ecumenical appeal for Protestants. Its source is the Apostolic Tradition, a liturgical text allegedly used in Rome, attributed to the 3rd century antipope Hippolytus, and reconstructed by Dom Bernard Bott, OSB. But Bott's text was not used integrally, and by now in this series you probably are able to guess why. Sure enough, according to liturgical scholar Father Enrico Mazza, it contained, quote, terms and expressions that our present-day theological outlook would cause us to misinterpret, unquote. Translation, those which would contradict modernist theology. Here are some examples of the omitted phrases. Christ as the angel of thy will. This was removed because it was mystical. God forbid. Our Lord dies, quote, in order to free from suffering those who had faith in you. Obviously, this is insufficiently universalist in its outlook, because it implies that only those who have faith will be freed from suffering. Our Lord undergoes his passion so that he could break the bonds of the devil, trod hell underfoot, and lead the just to light. Insufficient universalism again, not to mention concepts that do not reflect the mentality of modern man, that is, the devil and hell. Thanks to God, because he found us worthy to stand before him and to serve him, as priests. The as priests had to be omitted because it undermined the theology of assembly. Again, another bogus concilium restoration, and a restoration that actually came from a restaurant to boot. For in the modernist Louis Bouilhet's memoirs, published in 2014, we learned that Bouilhet and Dombot rewrote the text of EP2 in one night while seated at the table of a Roman restaurant.
Talk about those called to the supper of the Lamb.
And as if this were not enough, in 2010, the world-renowned expert in ancient liturgical texts, Paul Bradshaw, endorsed the conclusion that the prayer in question had no connection with Rome or Hippolytus.
The ancient Roman statue used to link the prayer to Hippolytus, moreover, turned out not to be Hippolytus at all. Researchers discovered it was an ancient statue of a woman that 16th century restorers had cleverly altered and transformed into a statue of a bishop. The implications of this fact for the debate over women's ordination and ministry to the transgendered we will leave to others.
EP3, The Roman Tradition. Much of this text is the work of Cipriano Vagagini, and it resembles his Project B, a text he proposed in his book Attacking the Roman Canon. EP3 is merely another text dreamed up in the mid-1960s. Three expressions in the text are noteworthy. First, the phrase, "You gather a people to yourself so that a pure offering would be made to your name." This, the Ottaviani intervention observes, attributes to the congregation autonomous priestly powers, perfectly consonant with the modernist theology of assembly. Second, the phrase pilgrim church on earth. Far from being a notion drawn from Roman liturgical tradition, this expression is a pure Vatican IIism. It's the popular modernist code word for dogmatic and disciplinary evolution. Pilgrims of this sort are always on a journey and never arrive at a goal. Third, the phrase sacrificium vivum et verum, a holy and living sacrifice. This phrase Bugnini attributed to Theodore of Mopsuestia. Great tradition there. Theodore and his theological writings were condemned as impious by the Second Council of Constantinople in 553, and he is regarded as having been, practically speaking, a Nestorian heretic. EP4, Salvation History.
This Eucharistic prayer has an unchangeable preface that must always be used, and the whole prayer is a didactic Bible history lesson.
The Reformers claimed that EP4 is modeled on Eastern Rite Eucharistic prayers, but why not use one of those prayers verbatim? Well, all these were loaded with language that modernists regard as insufficiently sensitive to the mentality of modern man. So EP4 is in fact mostly the work of Cipriano Vagagini. It is similar to Project C in his Dump the Roman Canon book, and thus just another 1960s creation. But EP4 did seem to hearken back to at least one ancient source. Because its preface addressed God the Father with the phrase, "You alone are God, living and true," it was nicknamed the Arian Canon.
And since you've already made the Nestorian heretics happy with EP3, why not cheer up the Arians with EP4?
EPs 1 and 2 for Reconciliation.
We now turn to the first set of what I call the Hippie EPs, because their language so thoroughly reflects the trite, "we are all one" ideological cliches of the 60s and 70s era. Here are some examples.
"You do not cease to challenge us to a more abundant life. United the human family to yourself. The power to serve all human beings.
the human race is fragmented by dissension and discord. Enemies engage in conversations. Adversaries shake hands. Peoples seek encounters. Make your church to be, in the midst of humanity, a sign of unity and an instrument of your peace. Bring all human beings of whatever rank and station into the banquet of abiding unity.
So instead of saying Amen at the end of one of these, you suspect that your response should really be a little more culturally appropriate.
EPs 1 to 4, for various needs.
The second batch of four Hippie EPs is based on options contained in the Eucharistic prayer approved for the 1974 Swiss Synod. These are loaded with more cliches about pilgrim people, we're on a journey, and here you are, God, in the midst of us.
You are always present to them in the journey of life. Your Son is present in our midst. Open our eyes to acknowledge the needs of our brothers. May your church appear as a living testimony of truth and liberty, peace and justice. When this earthly pilgrimage is completed, you now accompany your pilgrim church in the world. Examining the signs of the times.
It's getting so much stronger. It's a sign of the times. And I know that I won't have to wait.
These thoughts are so shallow, the image is so trite, and the language is so debased that it's nearly parody. We're all on that Hippie VW bus for the pilgrimage of life, and God is our tour guide.
EPs 1 to 3, for children. These are used at masses celebrated with pre-adolescent children, and are governed by the Children's Directory. This document was Bognini's pride and joy, his own personal creation, and it received the approval of Paul VI himself. The entire Children's Directory is based on an understanding of the Mass as a religious classroom and on worship as pedagogy. The second and third Eucharistic prayers for children feature a number of acclamations that interrupt the text, the idea being that children have a short attention span. The children's Eucharistic prayers are written in theological baby talk, and their tone is horizontal and cheery, about the big, beautiful world.
The notion that you have to debase the Mass to engage children's attention and participation is idiotic.
In Catholic grade school before Vatican II, we sang the Latin High Mass every day. Every day, with a chance in this book. In the third or fourth grade, we learned how to follow Mass with our missals. We loved it. Even, and maybe especially, the future troublemakers in our group. And so today, our children at St. Gertrude the Great School sing High Mass every day. Listen to our 11:20 a.m. school Mass someday. And tell me that you have to debase the liturgy to engage children. Ecumenical intercessions. The Roman Canon contains various intercessory prayers for the living and the dead members of the church militant and the church suffering. Ancient church discipline dictated that those who were not members of the church were excluded from her public prayers, apart from prayers offered for their conversion.
Even though this principle was indeed part of the pristine norms of the fathers that the creators of the post-Vatican II liturgy professed to restore, they ignored it entirely when composing the new Eucharistic prayers.
Thus, in Concilium's guidelines for catechesis on the new Eucharistic prayers, we find the following statement. The universalist and ecumenical viewpoints of Vatican II and of the so-called theology of the world, have a restrained, biblical but real echo in these Eucharistic prayers. Liturgical scholar Robert Cabier provides a number of examples. Bring them and all the departed into the light of your presence. All your children, wherever they may be. Those whose faith is known to you alone.
Nor is this treatment limited to heretics and schismatics, who at least lay claim to the title Christian. Even pagans get in on what Cabier calls the EP's universalist perspective.
During one of my mass sampling forays in the Diocese of Rochester in the 1980s, I personally heard a colleague of Father Chuck take such ecumenism to its logical conclusion. In the Eucharistic prayer, the priest named not only the bishop of the Catholic Diocese of Rochester, but also the local Protestant Episcopal bishop.
What seemed like parody then was merely 30 years ahead of its time. Changes in the consecration. We now turn to the most important and sacred part of the canon, the consecration.
In the traditional Mass, the term consecration refers to the section of the Roman Canon that contains the words spoken by our Lord at the Last Supper, which transform the bread and wine into his body and blood. The rubrics for the traditional Mass call these words the words of consecration. The rubrics for the traditional Missal further specify that these words are the form of the sacrament, that is, the short essential formula in each sacramental rite that actually produces the sacrament's effect. As with the priestly gestures in the canon, these details, when taken together, point to the whole magnificent edifice of Catholic teaching on the Blessed Sacrament, the priesthood, and the holy sacrifice of the Mass.
Retaining the vestiges of this, of course, was out of the question, so the terminology applied to this part of the Mass, as well as the very texts themselves, had to be altered according to the tenets of ecumenism and modernism.
First, terminology. Instead of referring to the consecration, or the words of consecration, the creators of the new Mass signaled what they were up to in paragraph 55d of the 1969 General Instruction, where they spoke of the institution narrative and the words of the Lord. This is the language of classical Protestantism, as explained by the Lutheran liturgist Luther Reed. Quote, the consecration is not effected mechanically and at a precise moment and place by the recitation of the dominical words, as the Romanists teach. We dare not limit the thought of consecration to the precise moment at the recitation of the verba. We rejected the category of space inherent in the doctrine of transubstantiation. We dare not retain the category of time inherent in the same false doctrine. As we do not limit the divine presence to wafer or wine, so we should not even seem to restrict divine power to a single moment.
This is also the modernist position. Thus, in his 1954 work Liturgical Piety, Louis Bouyer, who also helped compose the new Eucharistic prayers, characterized the emphasis on the consecration as a retrogression from true religion into magic, and as part of a tendency to disintegrate the Christian Eucharist. Second, the revisers modified the liturgical texts themselves to conform with these ideas. Thus, where the consecration section in the traditional Missal consists of two introductory passages followed by the words of consecration for the bread and wine respectively, in the new Eucharistic prayers, the revisers altered the text of the rite itself to produce a historical narrative with two quotes, the words of the Lord. Third, the revisers reinforced the narrative mode for the new words of the Lord by removing the phrase Mysterium Fidei, the mystery of faith, from the words of consecration over the chalice.
This particular expression, commentaries on the traditional Mass tell us, proclaims belief in the miracle of the real presence brought about by the words of consecration.
The revisers excised it and relocated it to introduce one of the three newly created memorial acclamations, which, instead of proclaiming the real presence as the mystery of faith, proclaim it to be instead Christ's coming at the end of time, or the memorial, that vague word again, of his cross and resurrection. Is this a case of that rascally Bugnini pulling one over on Paul VI, who after all had even written an encyclical entitled Mysterium Fidei? Hardly. Paul VI himself ordered Concilium to compose these acclamations, because he feared that if the choice of texts were left to bishops' conferences, quote, unsuitable acclamations would be introduced, such as Dominus Meus et Deus Meus, my Lord and my God. So, the consecration becomes a narrative, the sacramental form becomes a words of the Lord, quote, and the real mystery of faith is no longer transubstantiation, but a future or past event.
If you subscribe to the tenets of modernist sacramental theology, this will pose no problem. According to the principles of traditional Catholic sacramental theology, however, reciting the words of consecration as a narrative manifests a defect of intention that in turn renders the consecration invalid. But I'm not exactly the first person to point this out.
Already in 1969, the Ottaviani intervention noted some of the details mentioned above, and raised just this possibility.
Thus, the crowning glory of the modernist despoliation of the hated Roman canon. Substantial changes in the form of the sacrament that alter the intrinsic sense of the words, change the ministerial intention, and render the consecration and the Mass of Paul VI invalid. No body, no blood, no Mass.
Summing up.
Given the opportunity to correct what they called the deplorable impoverishment and liturgical decadence of the Roman canon by introducing other Eucharistic prayers from the much-touted golden ages of liturgical antiquity, the revisers took from those sources only those concepts and phrases that could be reconciled with the mentality of modern man, that is, the modernist worldview. Thus, instead of Hippolytus, the rediscovered ideal of the Eucharistic prayer, or the substance of the Eastern canons, in the Mass of Paul VI we get stripped down, half-plagiarized texts that modernist scholars cobbled together in the 1960s. Or we get totally new creations, complete with shallow 1960s humanist God-in-our-midst theology. And for children, we even get theological baby talk. All this is seasoned with the modern and modernist desideratum of ecumenism towards heretics, schismatics, and pagans, a notion that would have filled early Christians with horror. So, Dom Prosper Guéranger's observation is once again right on the mark. Liturgical reformers who begin by saying they will restore Christian antiquity always end up by producing new formulas no older than the day before. To find out more about the new Eucharistic prayers, read Deplorable Impoverishment, Chapter 12 of Work of Human Hands, a Theological Critique of the Mass of Paul VI. Our next broadcast, The Communion Rite. To order Work of Human Hands, visit www.sggresources.org.